Hello, and welcome to another EE140 video. Today's example is question number 2 on our homework on RF circuits. So let's begin. So once again, we're tasked to find Z in, gamma in, VSWR in the 75 ohm transmission line. And we are told that operating frequency is 1.59 gigahertz. And that the system impedance is 50 ohms. So this is system impedance. So whatever we connect to the transmission line, it's going to be running on 50 ohms. Now we're also tasked to find the input return loss and the maxima along the transmission line. So we need to locate them all. So to get started, we need our Z in, or our impedance seen from the input, right? So that means that's the sum of all the impedances to the right of this line. And we could start doing so with this ZL, and we can see that it's connected in series with this inductor. So we could start from that. So ZL is just 25 ohms. And our Z inductor, remember, it's J omega L, which is, that just comes out as J 99.9, which we can just round off to J 100. Now adding these two together, it's just going to be, so let's name that Z2. That's just going to be ZL plus Z inductor. Now we added those two, we could add this component over here. But what is this? We know that this is a stub. And we know that this stub is connected in parallel. So that's going to be a shunt. And we can see that this stub is open. So we'll just call that ZSSO. And we have a formula for our open stub, which is just negative J Z naught cotangent beta L. Now, since this is connected in parallel, and we need to add it with our Z2, we need to get this into admittance form. So that's just going to be 1 over negative J Z naught cotangent beta L. Remember, 1 over J is negative J. So same thing here. It's 1 over negative J. It's going to be negative, negative J. It just comes out as J. So over here, it's just J. And then 1 over Z naught is 1 over 100, right? Now, how about 1 over cotangent? So that is just simply tangent beta L. Now let's go ahead and calculate for our electrical length. Beta L, that is 2 pi over lambda, and our length here is 0.6 lambda, so that's 0.6 lambda. The lambdas cancel, so we just have 1.2 pi. Now we need to take the tangent of this 1.2 pi for this one, right? It's up to you if you want to use radians or degrees. So if you want to use radians, you could just switch your calculator to radians, take tangent 1.2 pi, you should be getting 0.73. Now if you're taking or you want to do degrees, so that's going to be 1.2 pi times 180 divided by pi. The pi's cancel, and you just get 216 degrees and tangent of 216 degrees is also 73 or 0.73. Now that we have those values, we can substitute it over here. So J 0.01 times 0.73. And that just comes out as 0.0073. And that is the value for our admittance for stub shunt open. Now that we have this in admittance, let's convert our Z2 into our Y2. So that's just going to be 1 over Z2. That is 1 over 25 plus J100. And we're going to convert the denominator to polar form. So that's just, right? And it's also good practice to have the rectangular form ready. So this is just 0024 negative J0.0094. Okay, so that is our admittance for these two. Now we could add our stub with our Y2, and we'll designate that as Y3. So Y3 is equals to Y2 ASSO. Now we're going to be using our rectangular form for Y2 plus. Remember, our inductor is purely imaginary number. Now we add the imaginary with imaginary. That's just going to be, so that is our Y3. So now we're ready to add our transmission line. And remember this formula? So now that we're adding our transmission line, you have two options. You either convert Y3 into Z3 and use this formula, or just stay with Y3 and use this formula. So for this problem, I'm going to be using this formula since I'm already at admittance. So let's go ahead and use that. So let's name this Y X line for the transmission line. So Y naught. So Y naught is going to be, remember, we're using this Z naught for the transmission line. So Y naught is equals to 1 over Z naught. That is 1 over 75. So that is our Y naught. So 1 over 75 times Y3. We'll be using the rectangular form. So once again, we need to calculate our tangent beta L. So beta L, because remember, this is different from our stub. So this is different from this. We have to use these parameters. Our beta L is going to be 2 pi over lambda. And our length is 1.7. So 1.7 lambda. Lambdas cancel. It's just going to be 3.4 pi. Now, again, it's up to you if you want to go radians. If you want to do it degrees, then we have to convert this. So now that we have those values, let's just plug it in over here. Let's replace this tangent beta L with 3.078. Now, moving on to the next line. So let's be very careful this step. This one just comes out as. So what I just did is just distribute this one to the numerator. And then on the denominator, I distributed J. And then multiplied it by this. and then added this. So that's what I get. Now we need to add these two imaginary numbers, convert both the denominator and numerator into polar form, and we get. Now, once we arrive here, we just divide the magnitude and subtract the angles to get that is the admittance for all this for the transmission line, the stub, and these two things. Now, we still need to add this resistor over here. So that's what we're gonna do next. And since that's the last, we could name this Yin, because we just summed up all the impedances. And Yin is equals to, and we'll be using our rectangular form, plus, so this is ZR, and we need YR, so that's 1 over ZR, that's just 1 over 30. And that yields, so we add the real with the real. So now that we have our admittance in, or Y in, we could just convert that into impedance and get our Z in. Converting the denominator to polar, we have So now that we have our Z in, so now we just need to find our gamma in. Remember, gamma in is difference of impedances on the numerator, sum of impedances in the denominator. So again, impedances over here versus the impedances over here. And to the right, it's just Z in. To the left, it's just the impedance of the system. So whatever we connect to this. So our gamma in is going to be Z in minus Z naught over Z in plus Z naught. And like we discussed, this is what we're going to use, our Z in rectangular form. It's 18.7 minus 18.7. Right? So that just comes out as, and we need to convert top and bottom to polar form. Now if you're getting different angles from me, remember this is Y and this is your X and they're both negative. So this is in the third quadrant. So whatever angle you get from inverse tangent of these two, you add 180 and you get this. Bottom part on the denominator, this is negative y, positive x, so that's in the fourth quadrant. So whatever you get from your inverse tangent plus a 360 degrees to it, and you get this. Now we divide the magnitude with the magnitude in bottom and subtract the angles, and we get 'Move on to finding our VSWR. But before we do so, since we just found out our gamma in and we need to find the input return loss, we can do that real quick. So remember, our return loss, RL for short, it's negative 20 log rho, where rho is the magnitude of gamma. So since we're looking for input return loss, the gamma here is going to be gamma in. So therefore, the magnitude that we're going to use is this one, magnitude of gamma in. So that just comes out as negative 20 log 0.482337, and that just comes out as 6.36 decibels. So now that we got the return loss or input return loss out of the way, we can now proceed to finding our VSWR. Now, VSWR is 1 plus rho over 1 minus rho. And this is the measure of how well the load matches with the transmission line. And we know that rho is just like on top. Rho is the magnitude of gamma. We just have to find out what gamma we need to use. And remember I said that VSWR is a measure of how well the load matches with the transmission line. So let's draw a line between them. So this is your transmission line, and this is going to be the other side. Now it's not just going to be the load, but the sum of all impedances to the right of your transmission line. So pretty much the gamma that we're going to be using, right? It's going to be the impedances from here. So that's your transmission line versus the impedances over here. And that is the sum of these three. So if you look for the sum of those three, let's see, that's going to be this one, right? So we are going to use this value over here to find our VSWR. So we could calculate our gamma. Let's just call it gamma 3. So that's going to be Z3 minus Z0, Z3 plus Z0, right, to find gamma. But remember, this one is in admittance form. So it's either we convert it to impedance, or we could just use this admittance calculation for gamma. And that is going to be Y0 minus Y3 over Y0 plus Y3. Notice that Y0 here comes first as opposed to Z3 comes first when doing the impedance calculation. So just be aware of that. So what's our Y0? This Y0. That's going to be. Now we just need to convert denominator and numerator to polar form. So that is just going to be 0.701 angle of 18.47 degrees. Number 10 minus negative 60. So that's why it's 18.47. Now, in calculating VSWR, we just need the magnitude of gamma, right? So VSWR is just 1 plus 0.701 over 1 minus 0.701. And this one just comes out as 5.69, right? Which is pretty high if you consider it, right? Because we know that 1.1 to somewhere 1.9 means good match with the transmission line or load transmission line match. And anything 2 or greater is not a good match. So now that we're done with our VSWR, the last task we have is to find the maxima or the maximas in the transmission line. Axis along the transmission line, we need this equation, right? And we also need to take note that our transmission line length is 1.7 lambda, and if that is 1.7 lambda, this position over here is 0, and on this side, that's going to be negative L, right? So now we're ready to find it out. So first location is when N is going to be 0. So let's do this. N equals 0, N equals 1, N equals 2, 3, 4, and 5, right? So we'll try N equals 0. So when N equals 0, this whole term is 0. So it's just going to be this phase angle. But now where is this theta going to be coming from? It's going to be the phase angle of our gamma load. Remember? So if we have the first one, let's do for N equals 0, right? So we have negative 18.47 plus minus, this whole thing is going to be 0 because N equals 0. We multiply that by lambda 4 pi, right? And since this is in degrees, this one just comes out as 18.47. We're going to convert it to radians, right? So this one's degrees. We need to convert it to radians. So the pi's cancel out. So 18.47 divided by 180 times 4. And you get, let me just write that down again. You get 0.256 or 0.0256 lambda. So that means that at N equals 0, with this phase angle, our max is at 0.0256 lambda. Alright, now we do the same thing again for N1, N2, N3, N4, and so on and so forth. This one is just the same as adding 0.5 lambda, right? Because if this is 0, cancel that. So it's just going to be lambda over 2. So that's the same as 0.5 lambda. So if this is our starting, or this is the max that is closest to the load, if we just add 0.5 lambda into that, we'll get our n equals 1. So if you don't believe me, you could go ahead and try getting the points using the n, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Again, we add 0.5. Once again, we add 0.5 lambda. Now, if we add another one, we're gonna get, remember, our length is just 1.7 lambda. That's the transmission line length. So this is greater than this, so therefore we are limited to this. So that means we only have 4 maximum along the transmission line. So there is going to be no N5. So max, Vmax at first is going to be 0.0256 lambda. Second one is 0.5256 lambda. Third one is going to be 1.026 lambda. And the last one is 1.526 lambda. There you have it. I hope this problem was made clear to you. I apologize if it was long, but I just want to be thorough. Thank you for watching and have a great day.